This week on Book Notes, our guest is Henry Louis Gates, Jr., chairman of the Afro-American Studies Department at Harvard University. He joins us to discuss his recent book, Colored People.
Henry Louis Gates, Jr., author of Colored People. Why the title?
Well, we were colored in the 1950s, and this is a book that attempts to recount what it was like to be of African descent in the United States between 1950 and roughly 1970. And partly it's a book about names and naming, and not only the names that the race has given itself, from colored people to Negro to black, ultimately to African American, but also one's own names. As you know, I talk about the names that were given to me at different points in my life, and then finally when I was 25, I took my father's name.
Where'd you get the name Skippy?
From the time I was born, the day I was born, my Uncle Raymond called me Skipper, and then it became Skippy. We were Piedmont's on a river. Piedmont, West Virginia, is on the Potomac River, 2 hours west of Washington, so there's a whole marine mentality there, and so I became the Skipper.
Before we go back and talk about the past, what are you doing now?
I'm the chairman of Afro-American Studies at Harvard and a professor of English.
And how long have you been doing that?
This is the beginning of my fourth year.
You write to your daughters in the beginning, and you suggest that eventually, after going through all the different names, they may get back someday to calling people of African-American descent or whatever colored.
Yeah,
do you really think so?
Well, it could well be. I mean, stranger things have happened. You see, most people don't realize that we called ourselves African in this country in the 18th and throughout the 19th century. I mean, not African-American, but African. For example, the African Methodist Episcopal Church, which was formed in the late 18th century, has that name to describe black people. So the names have always been mutable. We've always been at war with racism in this country, and one of the arenas of that war, one of the crucial arenas of that war, was the issue of names. Because we had the most hideous name put upon us by the most hideous aspect of the American public, and that, of course, was nigger. So nigger was always at the base, the foundation, the bottom line, and we were always running away from that kind of aspersion.
I didn't do it, but if I had more time, I think I would have gone through and counted the number of times you used the word nigger in the book.
Quite a lot.
What's the point?
Well, I'm quoting people. I'm quoting my father, I'm quoting my uncles, I'm quoting sometimes my mother, the people I grew up with. This is a book about black vernacular culture. This is a book about what black people thought and felt when no white people were around. I tried to imagine myself as a video camera on the sofa of our living room circa 1955, 1960, 1965, and finally 1970. And we use the word nigger all the time. Sometimes it's used very lovingly, sometimes it's used in a mean-spirited way. But it is a natural part of our culture, of our language.
Where'd the word come from?
Well, it's a debasement of negro, which is Spanish for black.
Did you ever, though, go and find the exact spot where that name started, where that word started?
No, linguists have. They can trace it to the 17th century. And it's, again, a debasement of Negro or a debasement of Niger, N-I-G-E-R, like the Niger River, or Nigars, N-I-G-A-R-S, which the word, excuse me, the word which was used to describe the first 20 or so slaves who came to Jamestown in 1619.
How many daughters do you have?
Two daughters, Maggie and Liza, ages 14 and 12, going on 40.
Now, have they read this book?
Yeah, they have, actually, and they've attended two readings that I've given of the book, of parts of the book. And I always read the preface when they're in the room because it's, as you know, it's in the form of a letter written to them. The whole book, in its first draft, was written in the form of letters to Maggie and Liza. I was in Italy at the Rockefeller Foundation Conference Center at Bellagio, which is on Lake Como, near Milan. And I woke up the first day there, and it reminded me so much of Piedmont. It's on this beautiful lake. Piedmont's on the banks of the mighty Potomac. Bellagio has the pre-Alps coming down to the left, hitting the lake, and we had the mighty Allegheny Mountains. And so by extension, I reimagined myself at home, and it was wonderful. And the girls were back in Boston, and so I wrote them a letter every day. So each chapter was called a date. The first was July 10th, the second was July 11th, and I wrote them 20 to 30 pages a day for 2 weeks I lost 10 pounds doing it. Went down the Milan, came back, and then I finished the first draft of the book over the next 4 weeks. It was quite exciting for me.
By the way, how does somebody get to go to Italy under the Rockefeller aegis to do this kind of thing?
Oh, so you just contact the Rockefeller Foundation. They'll send you an application. It's quite competitive. But lots of scholars and creative writers and creative artists and potters and sculptors, dancers, musicians apply. I think there are 14 or 15 scholars and artists in residence at any given time, and you stay for 5 or 6 weeks, you're very well treated, and it's a glorious experience.
I'm going to jump to something that was that you and I had in common after I read this book, and that was growing up listening to John R.
You listened to John R.?
Well, I remember it was John R. and John Richburg,
uh-huh.
and I also listened to somebody by the name of Gene Nobles.
Uh-huh, that's right.
Now, why did we both listen to that same radio station in Nashville, Tennessee?
I guess you're an octoroon, and you've been passing all this time.
Who was John R.?
John R., I saw an article about him in the Times in the 70s, and he was this white guy who sounded black and loved black music and black culture. And I think many of us would have been shocked in the 50s and 60s to know that John R. was this white southern mountain guy who was in love with black culture. But he played both gospel music and soul, rhythm and blues. And that was my education, my first encounter with black music on a national scale, as it were. But I have been surprised by how many people throughout the South, but you're from the Midwest, who have who depended upon John R. and Randy's Record Shop for their nightly infusions of black culture. You certainly weren't getting it through WKYR or whatever it was called in Kaiser, West Virginia. I mean, basically, I was raised with country music, hillbilly music.
Well, when I grew up in Indiana, we used to listen to Ernie's, Buckley's, Randy's Record Shop, and they had these disc jockeys that talked to, you know, it was the talk of the day and all that, and I just wondered how we both came to that radio station, what influence it might have had on that whole area. And how could you, was it difficult to hear it in Piedmont, West Virginia?
Yeah, you couldn't get it in the day, you could only get it at night. It was on AM, it was very scratchy, but you would solder your radio dial to its point on the dial and listen to it every night. And I had an older brother who was 5 years older, and so he was tuned into the world, and I was just the beneficiary of his wit and wisdom. And he would wait till my parents were asleep, then he would turn it on low, and we had bunk beds, and I'd sit there and listen. And it was great. It was an aspect of black culture that I didn't encounter in my daily life. I remember ads for things like blackstrap laxatives, and they would sing the song just like you would sing a blues or a rhythm and blues. So it was very important to me. Then you could, as you know, then you could order the records. So we would order these 45s through Randy's Record Shop, which again we could not get in our local record stores. But the fact that you were raised on this just as I was indicates how integrated black and white culture really was even in the 1950s and 1960s, though America officially denied it. Officially, you remember, we had this white Anglo-Saxon derived culture. And so everybody else's culture, particularly black culture, was subterranean, driven underground because it was an embarrassment. You know, you couldn't, it was the relative you couldn't take out to dinner. And but through popular culture, through electronic culture, all those barriers started to break down. MTV, of course, is the example for this generation. Though MTV took a long time to integrate. I don't know if you remember, but they wouldn't show any black artists. I mean, that's bizarre in 1970s, 1980s, but they wouldn't show any black artists, and then they started showing Michael Jackson and then Prince, and now you might think of MTV as a primitivist postmodernism. I mean, it's so black, and sometimes I think it's even borderline racist. And
there's another thing that I used to listen to on WLAC in Nashville on these same programs, mm-hmm. that you talk about in an indirect way, and that was things like Silky Straight,
mm-hmm.
and Royal Crown Pomade.
That's right.
But why did you, in your book, talk about the colored people and hair?
Well, we were obsessed with hair. In my community, we were obsessed with hair. And judging by the number of letters that I received from black people, throughout the country, in response to those sections of the book, I think the race was obsessed with hair. We were obsessed with hair and color, and that's a result of the slave system. The slaves who were mulattoes were obviously had been fathered by the owners of the slaves. They had obviously been fathered by white people.